Thank you. go back to.
And let's sing. We're going to ask you to sing this great hymn of At Calvary. This is, I know, is a lot of your favorites, mine too. Let's sing it out. Sing this as a testimony today.
Yes, I sing. My Lord,
neighbor next to him and look at him and say this, who died? Y'all look like you have just lost your best friend. Now, how can you sing this song and keep that kind of face going? You have to work at that. Are you glad for Calvary? Me too. Tannis, let's go back and put the worst of the chorus back up. I want to see some smiling faces. Let's go back and let's sing the chorus one more time. There we go. Mercy there was great. Let's sing that. And I want to see those teeth. Let's smile. We're singing. This is our testimony. All right? Lift your voice up and smile. Here we go. Mercy. When you've got a smile on your face, please be seated.
I'm afraid to walk up here without a smile on my face.
Better.
Right now. You know, before Greg said that, I thought that ran through my mind. I said, how can we sing this without joy in our hearts? You know, what the Lord has done for us at Calvary, and we're here to worship Him this morning. It's wonderful to be in God's house. And in 33 more minutes, it's going to be spring. And so that makes it even a better day. Did you know it officially comes at 10:33 this morning, Greg? 10:33 this morning, Tennessee time. We're in spring. So it's a great day. But it's good to see you. It's good to be in God's house today. Those of you that are guests, we're so happy you're here today. We had several guests in our first service. And I'm sure down in Wilson Hall this morning, as well as online, we have people that are with us for the first time. And we welcome each of you. We're here just to worship the Lord Jesus Christ in spirit, in truth, and in joy this morning. And hope that you will join us in that. Let's bow together in our prayer. Our Father, this morning, we are here for one reason, and that is just to worship You. Lord, Your blessings that You have bestowed upon us are manifold. You've just given us so many blessings. Just the privilege to be able to join together on this day. You've given us a beautiful day to worship You. Lord, to be a part of a family of faith that loves one another, that enjoys coming together, that truly understands fellowship. What a blessing. But Father, it's not about any of that. It's all about You today. We lift up the name of Jesus Christ. We honor Him. We give Him glory, for He alone has the name that is above all names. Lord, this morning we realize we have come from a myriad of experiences this past week. We've come with different needs in our lives, some with burdens. But Lord, today we cast them at Your feet. We realize, Father, that You care for each of us in such a great love, in that You have allowed us to be called Your children. So, Father, what could we do but not worship You today? So as we sing, Lord, we're not singing to sound good to one another. We're singing to You today. You're our audience. Lord, as we open Your word, we're doing so because we want to hear from You today. And, Lord, You work in incredible ways in our midst. Lord, we thank You for our partner churches. We thank You for One Community Church in New York City. We pray for our mission team that is there today. Lord, allow them to be hands and feet of Jesus in that community. We pray for First Baptist at Madison, at Crossroads at Westmoreland. Lord, do a mighty, mighty work in each of those churches this morning as well. Now, Father, speak to us, show Yourself. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen.
my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? Was it for crimes that I had done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing beauty, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light, it was there. By faith I receive my sight. Well, like the sun in darkness hide and shut his glories in. When Christ the mighty thus might I hide my blushing face while Calvary's cross appears. Dissolve my heart in thankfulness and melt my eyes to tears. Won't you stand and join us?
At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. My Savior's cross.
Lord, be honored with our praise this morning. Be honored by our thanks, O Lord. Be honored by our praise. Be honored and be glorified. We bless your name. We bless your name. Be honored by our thanks, O God. Be honored by our praise. Be honored and be glorified. We bless your name.
Oh, we bless your name.
We bless your name.
Thank you, Scott, and to all musicians this morning. That song really does give us our definition of worship, and that is give glory, honor to the name of Jesus Christ. If you'll open your Bibles this morning to John chapter 3, we're going to be looking at a passage of Scripture, verses 4 through 10. A cursory reading of this passage of Scripture appears that this is a difficult passage of Scripture. And it is somewhat, but as we break it down, we can see that John gives us some great truths that will help us as we understand sin, and particularly victory over sin in the life of Christians. Have you noticed that people are drawn toward extremes? Extreme adventures, extreme sports. A lot of the reality shows that are on TV today are about extreme wipeout. Some of these shows, that it just seems like extreme. Well, when it comes to the matter of sin, it seems that people are drawn toward one of two extremes. On one side, people are drawn toward this extreme of sin in that a person will say, if one has come to faith in Christ and is truly in Jesus Christ, that person will not sin, that there is an idea of sinless perfection. Now, it's going to appear that that's what John is saying, but we have to be careful with that. But there's also another extreme, and it was very prevalent in John's day as well as our day also, and it's this idea that if a person has truly come to faith in Jesus Christ, then they are secure in Him. They have their ticket punched to heaven, and so therefore, we can pretty much do whatever we want to do. Our physical life, our spiritual life are separated from one another. And so eat, drink, and be merry. Let's do whatever we want to do. Well, John plows right down the middle of these extremes in giving us the reality of sin, but yet at the same time showing us how we can have victory over sin. Beginning in verse number 4 of 1 John chapter 3, everyone who commits sin also breaks the law. Sin is the breaking of law. You know that He was revealed so that He might take away sins, and there is no sin in Him. Everyone who remains in sin in Him does not sin. Everyone who sins has not seen Him or known Him. Little children, let no one deceive you. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as He is righteous. The one who commits sin is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. The Son of God was revealed for this purpose, to destroy the devil's works. Everyone who has been born of God does not sin because his seed remains in him. He is not able to sin because he has been born of God. This is how God's children and the devil's children are made evident. John gives us a definition of sin. In verse number 4, he says, everyone who commits sin breaks the law. Sin is the breaking of law. Now, in Scripture, we have several different places where a definition is given of sin. In Proverbs chapter 24, it says, a foolish scheme is sin. James tells us in James chapter 4, it is a sin for a person to know to do good, and yet if that person doesn't do it, it is sin. Over in chapter 5, verse number 17, John writes, all unrighteousness is sin. But in chapter 3, our passage, he kind of pulls it all together, and he simply says it this way. Sin is the breaking of law. Sin is the breaking of law. Now, the question is, what's the law? What's law? Well, our first thought is probably to go to the Old Testament, the Mosaic Law, and yet that can't be what John is talking about because this is post-cross. The Old Testament law has been fulfilled, and so it can't be the Old Testament law. So what's he saying here? You know, while the Old Testament law has been fulfilled, God still has His commands. God still has His rules. He still has His regulations for our life. John talks about this over in chapter 5. He says, if you want to know if you're God's children, are you keeping God's commands? Are you loving others and keeping God's commands? And so God has commands for us. And so the breaking of law is the breaking of God's commands. And at the end of the day, it's all about defiance. It's all about rebellion at the end of the day. is that our will, we're placing our will above God's will by breaking God's commands. At the end of World War II, trials were held in Germany for many of the leaders, or several of the leaders, who were in the Nazi military and the government, known as the Nuremberg Trials. The Nuremberg Trials brought together the Allied countries, and so judges were placed to try these generals and try the leaders of the Nazi Germany government. The judges were from the United States and Russia and Great Britain and France. Well, the chief prosecutor was a United States Supreme Court justice who was bringing the case against these leaders for the atrocities they committed during the war. The problem arose, though, in that their defense was that they were simply following the commands of their leaders, and in fact, they were obeying the laws of their land. Prior to World War II, Hitler put in place some laws in Germany speaking against the Jewish race. In fact, the law said the Jewish race is a subhuman race. They're not even in comparison to the Aryan race. They're subhuman. And because they're subhuman, they're not even to be treated like human beings. And therefore, as we know, over 6 million Jews died in concentration camps or were murdered during World War II. The Jews were tortured. The Jews were raped. Unbelievable things were done against them. And so these leaders of Nazi Germany, in their defense, they said, we're just doing what the law of our land says we could and should do. Now, every nation on the face of this earth is civilized because of the laws of the country and because people are to obey the laws. And so it was really a good argument they were making. We were simply following the laws of our nation and of our leaders. But the prosecutor came back and he said, yes, that may be true, but there are laws above your law. He said, there are laws, he calls them the crimes against humanity, the crimes against peace. He said, there are laws against people murdering one another. There are laws against torturing other human beings. There are laws against rape and all of those things that you've done. And he even went so far to say, this is God's law that supersedes any nation's law. Supreme Court justice, prosecutor, had it correct. There are laws, there are commands that God has given us that supersedes any other laws that might be found out here. And John is saying the breaking of God's law is sin. But he goes immediately into verse 5 in saying, but the sin has been defeated. He's talking about Jesus Christ. He says, you know that he, Jesus, was revealed so that he might take away sins, and there is no sin in him. In this short passage of Scripture we're reading, John says Jesus came for two reasons: to take away sins and to destroy the works of the devil, found in verse number 8, that Jesus has come to take away the sins. And John says, and Jesus can take away the sins because he is qualified to do so. He is without sin. John's not the only one that says this. Paul says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. He says, God made Jesus, who did not know sin, to be sin for us so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Hebrews chapter 4, the writer says, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tested in every way as we are, yet without sin. In Hebrews chapter 7, for this is the kind of high priest we need, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. So John says, sin is breaking God's command, but Jesus has come to take away sin. And he says in verse 6, and you as a child of God, can be delivered from sin. Because Jesus has defeated sin, as Christians, we can be delivered from sins. Now, as you read that verse, verse number 6, everyone who remains in him does not sin. Everyone who sins has not seen or known him. It appears that John is talking about sinless perfection. That a Christian, if he's truly in Christ, cannot sin. Well, we've got a problem. Because back in chapter 1, John has already talked about sin in the life of Christians. Look at chapter 1, verse number 8. If we say we have no sin, we're deceiving ourselves and the truth is not in us. Now, John's not writing this to the ungodly world. He's writing this to Christians. And he's saying, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we don't have sin, we make God to be a liar, and his word is not in us. So what does John mean when he says everyone who remains in him does not sin? Well, we have to look at it in its context. We always read Scripture and study Scripture within its context. Verse 5 talked about Jesus being sinless. In him there is no sin. And in verse number 6, the key word, there is a key word that connects the verses together, and it is the word remains. Circle that word, highlight that word. There is your connecting word that helps us understand what he's saying. He's saying Jesus has come to take away sins. Jesus is qualified to do so because he's sinless. And everyone who remains in Jesus, there is no sin in him. Now, as we're studying this scripture, we find the word sin, singular. We find the word sins, plural. Sometimes we find it as a noun. Sometimes we find it as a verb, and we have to look at it and see what he's talking about. Sins are the fruit, but sin is the root. And he's talking about a root of sin in our life. When he's saying everyone who remains in him does not sin, it is present tense. The implication is right now, if we remain in Christ, we will not sin. Now, the word remain is used, there's a different word in different Bible translations. The King James Version uses the word abides. Great, great word. The NIV uses lives in. If a person lives in Jesus, they do not sin. Some of the paraphrases, they don't do it justice, quite justice. They talk about they will not habitually sin, but it's more than just not habitually sinning. If we remain in Christ, we will not have that root of sin in our life. Sin is real. We're born in sin. We're born with a sin nature. But Jesus has come to take away that rebellion that is in within us, that defiance that's within us. Jesus has come to take away that root of sin in our lives if we remain in him. Therefore, if we are in Christ, if we remain in Christ, if we abide in Christ, if we live in Christ, then we do not practice sin. It's not that we're going to live a life of sinless perfection, but we will not live a life of habitual rebellion against God and his commands. But John immediately goes into a statement in verse number 7, that in my Bible has an exclamation point behind it. Now, an exclamation point means he's emphasizing this. He says, little children, let no one deceive you. Let no one deceive you. John's day, there were deceivers. Matter of fact, if we go back up to chapter 2, verse 26, he says, I've written these things to you about those who are trying to deceive you. There were people there that were trying to deceive in that day. There are people, March 2022, that are trying to deceive us today. It has never stopped and it never will. Deception is part of the devil's plan. Deception takes many forms. Sometimes it takes the form doctrinally. The deception is they want us to believe something different about who Jesus is. Sometimes the deception comes morally in that they tell us it's okay to live this way, or this is the way it is. And deception in today's world tries to make right wrong and wrong right, and we know all of that. Let me give you an example of a prevalent deception in our world today. One of the prevalent deceptions in our world today is that you are who you are, and there's really not a lot you can do about it. That I was born this way, and that's just who I am. And we can do personality assessment tests, and we can do all these other things, and we come back and just say, well, this is how God made me. No, he didn't. I can't help it that I've got just, an explosive anger issue. That's just who I am. No, it's not. That's a root of sin in your life. You don't have to live in anger if you're remaining in Christ Jesus. You know, in our world, we've kind of categorized sins, haven't we? We've kind of categorized. We say, okay, some sins are bigger and worse than other sins. And you know, in our minds, that's the way it is. And by our law, that is true. We say these sins are worse than other sins. But what about in God's eyes? Sin is sin. God doesn't have a top 10 list of sins. He had the 10 commandments, but he doesn't have a top 10 list of sins. Sin is rebellion. It's breaking God's commands. And it doesn't matter if it's a big command or what we might say is a minor command. It's still a command that we have broken. Now listen, I want you to understand something. All of us have weak areas in our life. Every one of us in this room, we have some weak areas in our life. That is where Satan's going to hit you. Mark it down. Satan is going to hit you at your weak point. That's where he's going to tempt you. Satan is not going to waste his time trying to tempt you in areas where you have a strength. And so each of us would be really smart to say, what are the weak areas of my life? And then get ready to know that's where we're going to be tempted. When I was 14 years old, lived in Hot Springs, Arkansas, and I worked in a little store right across the street from the horse track. Hot Springs has a horse track, and right across the street from the horse track in Hot Springs. And before the races would start, they had a 60-day racing season in the spring of the year. Oftentimes, I'd stand at the front door and watch people go down the walk, the sidewalk, head over to the racetrack across the street. Well, we had this little store that I was employed, and there was a parking lot next door and then a liquor store next door to that. And there was a neighborhood drunk that just roamed out the street in front of us over to liquor store quite frequently, but he just roamed back and forth. Well, one morning as I was there at the window watching people go by, here comes this neighborhood drunk. And about as far as from me to Gene right here, he stumbles and falls into the street, and I see him get hit by a car and killed in front of my eyes. 14. From that day on, I have never been tempted to drink. I saw what alcohol did to this guy, and so I have never been tempted to drink from that day on. When I was in high school, when I was in college, when I was business world early in life, and around places where people drinking, I have never, ever been tempted to drink. So to this day, that's not where Satan tempts me. That's not my weak area. But he hits me where I am weak. And so what we're to do is we're to acknowledge, here's where I am weak, and then we are ready for the temptation. We never give in to the deceivers of this world that say you just can't help yourself because that's how God made you. It's not it. few months ago, we started a incredible ministry called Celebrate Recovery. It's to help people in their weak areas of life who have acknowledged they have a weak area. And for many of these people, they acknowledge that that weak area has led to an addiction in their life. Now, the reality is all of us got addiction, some form, some fashion, somewhere, because we all got weak areas. And yet, we kind of categorize these addictions, you know. There's drugs, there's alcohol, there's pornography, there's sex, and so forth. But keep in mind, there's also other addictions out there, like gossip and covetousness and laziness and a critical spirit. Now, he's meddling now, isn't he? But here's the deal. God has given us the Spirit of Jesus Christ, and when we remain in him, we don't remain in our addiction. We're an overcomer. Because a person has an addiction does not make them an addict. God has meant for us to overcome those areas and to be strong. In fact, the Bible says it is in the area where you are weak that I make you strong. But that only happens when we remain in him. Go back to that verse 6. We remain, we abide, we live in Jesus Christ. And that's when we have victory over sin. At the end of verse number 7, though, John presents what we might say is a counter argument right here. He moves it along, and from saying that we can have delivery from our sin to saying that we have a decision to make. Notice what he says. He says, the one who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The counter argument is this. The one who does what is righteous because Jesus is righteous. The opposite of sin is righteousness. And if we do what is right, then we don't have to worry about not doing what is wrong. I don't know if I could put more negatives in a sentence than I just did. But I'll just say it again. If we do what is right, then we don't have to worry about not doing what is wrong. Because we have Jesus' righteousness within us. Because we are in Christ. So the question is, how do we abide in Christ? Our pastor's answered this several times, but John keeps coming back to this time and time again, so I think we need to as well. How do we abide in Christ? Well, in chapter 2, verse 6, it says, if we are going to remain in Christ, then we will walk just as he walked. Christ is our pattern for life. As he walked, we walk. We watch what he did. We see what he has done in the scripture, and we emulate his life. But not only is he our pattern for life, but in chapter 4, verse 4, it says he is our power for life. Listen to this. You are from God, little children, and you have conquered them because the one who is in you is greater than he is in the world. We are in Christ. Paul says it this way in Galatians. Christ is my life. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It is Christ in me. I am in Christ. I wish you could have known my dad. My dad has been in heaven for 14 years. But my dad was a great, great guy. He would have loved meeting you and visiting with you. My dad never met a stranger in his life. He could talk to a brick wall and carry on a conversation. He loved life. He was active. He was a pastor. I just wish you could have met him. But if you want to see George Raley, just look right here because here he is. We look alike when pictures are posted on Facebook, my dad's friends will oftentimes respond, you're looking more and more like your dad all the time. I see George Raley when I look at you. We're the same height. We're the same build. I know we're supposed to get our hair from our mama, but I got my dad's hair. sparse on top, gone at the back. You know, I mean, we're like people that hear us preach, that heard my dad preach. They say, you preach just alike. You sound alike. Donna calls me George quite frequently. She's reminded of dad. Why am I my dad? Well, that's because, number one, I've got his DNA. I could get hair plugs and stuff, but there's nothing I can do. I've got George Raley DNA in me. But also, for 46 years, I remained in him. I abided with him. I lived with him. We didn't always live close together, but we were together. He's my dad. And dad and I remained in one another. Look at verse number 9 to close this out. Everyone who has been born of God does not sin, because his seed remains in him. The word seed in Greek is the word sperma. Think about that. God has put his spiritual DNA in you. And as we remain in him, then we will walk with him. We'll talk like him. We will act like him. We will react like him. And yes, we'll even look like him. But John closes this out in verse 10 with saying, this is how God's children and the devil's children are made evident. So I close the message with the question, who's your daddy? This is how God's children and the devil's children are made evident. Who's your daddy? Our Father, this morning, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you that while we live in a sinful world and we're born with a sinful nature, we thank you, Lord, that as we remain in you, we can have victory over a root of sin in our lives. We don't have to give in to the weak areas of our life where Satan's going to tempt us. We don't have to give in to sin itself. But instead, we can have the victorious life that you want us to have, and that brings joy to us and to you. Lord, if there is a person in this room today that they don't know Jesus Christ, I pray this morning, Lord, you'll give them just boldness. Give them courage this morning to walk down this aisle to say, I need Jesus as my daddy. Lord, this morning, if there's a person here that they're saved, perhaps years ago they received Christ, but they're not abiding in you today, and this morning your Holy Spirit has convicted them, Lord, I pray that they'll use this altar as a public way to saying, I want to remain in Jesus Christ. Lord, I know there are many needs across this congregation. I pray through your Holy Spirit that you'll speak to every single person. You'll show us how we're to respond. And Lord, you will give the boldness and the courage to do so. In the name of Christ Jesus, we pray. As we stand together, we're going to sing. This is a song of commitment that I surrender. Do you? I'll be here at the front. Jerry will be here at the front. We'd be honored to visit with you and to pray with you as the Lord speaks.
All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will Savior, I surrender.
Thank you, Greg. Thank you. To our guests, I'm going to be out in the foyer as we conclude. Please come by. I want to meet you this morning. Thank you for being here today. If you have a spiritual decision to make, I'll be out there. There'll be some other friends with me. We'd be honored to counsel you and visit with you. Let me share two or three things before we leave. I mentioned in the prayer that we have begun a partnership with Crossroads Baptist Church in Westmoreland for revitalization. This afternoon at 5 o'clock, we're having a prayer and praise service of Crossroads and our church coming together. We're going to spend just about an hour in just praise and music and in prayer, asking God's directions and blessings as we begin this revitalization partnership. I want to encourage you, if you can, to be there this afternoon at 5 o'clock. It would be a great encouragement to the people at Westmoreland to know that we truly are going to be partners, praying for them, supporting them, helping them to see a great church revitalized there. It's called Crossroads because it's at the crossroads of Highway 52 and 31. Now, if you get lost, just find Taco Bell, and it's right behind it, all right? You'll remember that. But at 5 o'clock this afternoon. Then we have a couple of business meetings coming up. We don't do it often, but we have one Wednesday night that will deal with some recommendations concerning the food bank. We're beginning a food bank to take care of Sumner County beginning April 1st, and we have a few recommendations that need to be approved by the church body, and so that'll be this Wednesday night, 6:30 in the chapel. And next Sunday morning, we are honored to have Dr. Brett Brandewee, his wife Laura, and his son Bobby here in view of a call as our next family pastor. Family pastor leads our preschool through our high school ministry, gives oversights. Dr. Brandewee is an incredible young man. God has just blessed us by bringing him to us. And so next week, you're going to get to meet him. His 7-year-old son is named Bobby Cash. So he is meant to live in Hendersonville, right? But you pray for Brett and Laura and Bobby, and they'll be here next Sunday morning. Greg?
You know, maybe next time I need for everybody to smile, I just need to show them my new socks. See if this brings a smile to your face.
We going to get this on camera?
Get that on camera.
There we go.
Cheez-Its.
That won't make you smile. That'll make you laugh.
Say cheese. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Have a great week. See you next time.